Morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
Welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. My name is Sean Hudgenwortle, and I will be your moderator for this morning's class. This school is not a church, and neither are we affiliated with any religious organization. This school is a nonprofit, non-denominational, religious and scientific research organization dedicated to showing proof of the existence of Yahweh, our Elohim, and the operation of his eternal purpose, pattern, and plan operating throughout eternity to this present day. This school was established as a result of a divine vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in the year of 1931. We were incorporated in the state of California in 1958. Since then, we've established various branch schools throughout the United States and in various foreign countries. The Ontario branch was established in May of 1988. At this time, I would like to introduce our president, the Ontario branch president, Dr. Christopher Williams, and the Ontario branch treasurer, Dr. Eunice Reiser. In this school, we use the true, correct, and original name and title for our Father, the Word or Son, and the Holy Spirit, as contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name for our Father, for our Heavenly Father, is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title for the Word or Son is Elohim. It has been improperly substituted by God. The name of the Holy Spirit manifested in or out of a physical body is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Lord and God are titles and not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8 and 5 that there are lords many and gods many. But we now know that each lord must have a name and each god must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This means that Elohim is the title that our Creator chose for himself. Jesus is a name, but Jesus is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part into a good dictionary or encyclopedia would prove that neither the Hebrew, Greek, or Latin language have any letters or characters in their alphabet that will produce the sound that is made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in the English language until some 1400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings for the true, correct name for our Father and His Son. Christ is a title just like Lord and God. Yahweh is pure spirit. And in his pure spirit state, he is incomprehensible, inscrutable, and indiscernible. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of all things.
We have Yahweh.
We have Yahweh symbolized on this chart as a cloud. Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize himself because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. We have this cloud drawn all around the edges of this chart to show you how that everything on this chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and form right within himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son. A super incorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without having flesh and blood. Later on, this self-same spirit manifested himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world calls Jesus Christ. Now, there's only one name given unto salvation, and we all must know that name. So the simple yet intelligent question that we should ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time he walked the earth plane? Further understanding of this name and title may be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also in this school, we teach by the divine pattern of the universe. It is called the divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt, he instructed Moses to come to the top of Mount Sinai, and he showed him a tabernacle pattern in a vision. This tabernacle pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court round about. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. We also in this school go forth to show proof how that everything in the universe is made and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and how that everything, or that nothing escapes the pattern, excuse me. Our 10 primary constitutional objectives and aims of the Institute are as follows. First, to help you find and know Yahweh, our Elohim, as he really is and actually exists. Second, to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah without distinction of race or nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third, to investigate the unexplained spirit law or so-called law of nature and the powers latent in man. Fourth, to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, and modern practical and occult science. Fifth, to extirpate current superstitions, skepticisms, and ignorance. Sixth, to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensations and ages. Seventh, to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan and his demons operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensations of time. Eighth, to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith which was once delivered to the sons or children of Yahweh. Ninth, to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained that there is no other name given among men whereby man can be saved, saving the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And tenth, to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace, and our slogan is speak the truth. Today we'll have a scripture lesson of Hebrews, the 12th chapter, and our scripture reader today will be Dr. Kennaway Kleinsmith, and we will have a prayer by Dr. Christopher Williams, and that will be followed by a selection of music. Thank you.
And when you use the pointer, there's a piece of black tape around there. That's where your hand goes. The reason why is to bring you into the picture.
Thank you.
Let's bow our hearts and minds in a moment of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father Yahweh, we thank you once again for allowing us to learn more about your purpose, pattern, and plan. We hope that whatever speaker gets on the floor is given the power to edify this body and everyone on the internet so that we can learn more about this purpose, pattern, and plan in simplicity. Give whoever's on this floor, this floor, to enough sustenance to provide for the class, and for everyone that's not here, we just give thanks that you're able to partake in this this great gospel, whichever way we can give it. All these things we ask in the only begotten Son of Yahshua Messiah. Let's all say,
Hallelujah.
Show me what you say. right, cut it.
Hebrews 12, wherefore, seeing we are also compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin that doth so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us. Looking unto Yahshua, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of Yahweh. For consider him that endured such contradiction of sinners against himself, that you be wearied and faint in your minds. Ye have not yet resisted unto blood, striving against sin. And ye have forgotten the exhortation which speaketh unto you as unto children. My son, despise not thou the chastening of Yahweh, nor faint when thou art rebuked of him. For whom Yahweh loveth, he chasteneth, and scourgeth every son whom he receiveth. If you endure chastening, Yahweh dealeth with you as with sons. For what son is he whom the father chasteneth not? But if you be without chastisement, wherefore all our partakers then are bastards and not sons. Furthermore, we have had fathers of our flesh which corrected us, and we gave them reverence. Shall we not much rather be in subjection unto the Father of spirits and live? For they verily for a few days chastened us after their own pleasure, but he for our profit, that we might be partakers of his holiness. Now no chastening for the present seemeth to be joyous, but grievous. Nevertheless, afterward it yieldeth the peaceable fruit of righteousness unto them which are exercised thereby. Wherefore lift up the hands which hang down and the feeble knees, and make straight paths for your feet, lest that which is lame be turned out of the way, but let it rather be healed. Follow peace with all men, and holiness without which no man shall see Yahweh. Looking diligently, lest any man fail of the grace of Yahweh, lest any root of bitterness springing up trouble you, and thereby may be defiled. Lest there be any fornicator or profane person, as Esau, who for one morsel of food sold his birthright. For ye know how that afterward, when he would have inherited the blessing, he was rejected, for he found no place of repentance, though he sought it carefully with tears. For ye have not come unto the mount that might not be touched, and that burneth fire, nor unto blackness and darkness and tempest. And the sound of a trumpet and the voice of words, which voice they that heard entreated that the word should not be spoken to them any more. For they could not endure that which was commanded. And if so much as a beast touched the mountain, it shall be stoned or thrust through the dirt. And if so much as a beast touched the mountain, it shall be stoned or thrust through with dirt. And so terrible was the sight that Moses said, I exceedingly fear and quake. But you are come unto Mount Zion, and unto the city of the living Elohim, the heavenly Jerusalem, and to an innumerable company of angels. To the general assembly and congregation of the firstborn which are written in heaven, and to Yahweh the judge of all, and to the spirits of just men made perfect, and to Yahshua the mediator of the new covenant, and to the blood of sprinkling that speaketh better things than that of Abel. See that ye refuse him not that speaketh, for they escape not who refuse him that spake on earth. Much more shall not we escape if we turn away from him that speaketh from heaven, whose voice then shook the earth, and now he hath promised, saying, Yet once more I shake not the earth only, but also heaven. And this word, yet once more, signifieth the removing of those things that are shaken, as of things that are made, that those things which cannot be shaken may remain. Wherefore, we receiving a kingdom which cannot be moved, let us have grace, whereby we may serve Yahweh acceptably with reverence and fear. For our Elohim is a consuming fire. That was Hebrews 12. Let us all say,
Hallelujah. Speaker format, and for our first speaker, I would like to call Iggy Ramirez.
Oh. Okay, good morning, class.
Good morning.
Okay, can you lower the volume a little bit? You heard the moderator. He says that Yahweh is pure spirit. All right? You can't see pure spirit. It's inconceivable. You know, you can't, there's no way to understand spirit. Okay? You ask out in the world, the people out in the world, you know, what's God? They say, well, you love all this stuff. You know, they can't give you well, what's the Heavenly Father? Well, he's spirit. Okay. Do you know him? Yes, I know him. Well, can you describe him? No, he's spirit, you know. Well, what is spirit? It's God. You know, so it's like a circle, a vicious circle going around. I remember because I was out there doing that stuff. Okay, so this is a school. It's called the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. Metaphysical means beyond the flesh. Okay? If you listen to the scripture lesson, he talks about things back here, talks about a mountain, okay, a quake and the sound of church. You have to know what's going on, okay? That's why we always say read the story, you know? Read the events that happened back to Moses, as the Messiah says. We have to go back to Moses, okay, and the prophets. Is anybody not familiar with this, Law and the Prophets? I think we all, you back there? Okay. Now, to understand Yahweh, spirit, okay, pure spirit, unconceivable, indescribable, and discernible, okay. Now, back in the day when I came in, all the time they used to say, let's get Romans 1, 19 and 20. That was a theme song to this school. Okay? Romans 1, 19 and 20, please.
Right.
So, if you don't know anything about Yahweh, this is what Paul says about it.
Romans 1, 19 and 20. Because that which may be known of Yahweh is manifest okay. in them.
So that which may be known of Yahweh is manifest in them. Read.
For Yahweh has showed it unto them.
For Yahweh has showed it unto them.
For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and supernal nature, so that they are without excuse.
Okay, so we have to look at the things that are made to understand Yahweh. Okay? First of all, we in the school didn't understand anything about Yahweh, period, or about the Messiah, okay? Until we met somebody that had some kind of affiliation with the school, okay? Now, It was shown to us, those that came in, about Yahweh. The first thing we know about Yahweh is what? When we meet somebody basically out in the street or somewhere, we have to understand, you're introduced to him by his name. Okay? Now, we all know, we all been through it. It's been proven to us. Okay? Or if it wasn't, we wouldn't be sitting here. Okay? We know now that his name is Yahweh, pluralistic title, pluralistic name, Elohim, pluralistic title, and Yahshua, okay? The Savior. It is proven to us because, get John 5 and 39, we have a certain rules we have to go by, okay, to understand it. But as I was going to say before, this divine, panoramic, stupendous vision was given to a man in 1931. His name was Dr. Henry Clifford Kenley. He is the founder of the school, was the founder, well, is the founder of the school. Okay? And by, when Yahweh said he showed it unto them, okay, he showed this vision. First of all, to Moses up in this mount, okay? Panoramic vision of Elohim to Moses. Over here, John received the panoramic vision of Elohim to John in AD 96. This is 1490 BY, okay? And in 1931, he showed this man a panoramic divine vision, okay? Now, it was for the world. If you read his little that little pamphlet, the Divine Vision, okay, or Panoramic Vision, he explains to you the event what happened to him, okay, how he seen this thing, and what was spoken to him, and I just replied, okay. Keep on reading.
John 5:39. Ye search the Scriptures, for in them you think you have eternal life. And they are they that testify of me.
Okay, this is Messiah. Okay, while he was walking around the earth plane, okay, he would say things like that, what his mission was. Okay, now, in order to understand him, he said you have to go to the law and to the prophets. Okay, when he came in 4,000 years later, okay, born to the loins of a Virgin Mary, okay, went into his ministry at the age of 30, got baptized by John in the River Jordan. Okay, let's pick that up over there when he gets baptized by John, where he comes up to John, where the Yahshua the Messiah comes to, I think it's 3:11.
Matthew 3:13.
Yeah.
Then cometh Yahshua?
Yeah.
Then cometh Yahshua from Galilee to Jordan unto John to be baptized of him. But John forbade him, saying, I have need to be baptized of thee, and comest thou to me? And Yahshua answering said unto him.
Okay, this is where they miss it. When they read this scripture out there in the world, read.
And Yahshua answering said unto him, permit it to be so now, for thus it becometh us to fulfill all righteousness.
And they miss it. Okay? They say, well, he's instituting right here, you know? Since he got baptized, we got to get baptized. Okay? Israel, all of Israel that came around to John to get baptized in the River Jordan. Why? Because they came confessing their sins. Okay? Now, Messiah came to John confessing no sin. And John said, well, I have to be baptized by you, you know, because you come confessing no sin. And Messiah's reply is, he came to fulfill. Okay? Fulfill what? Water baptism. Okay? Every bit of what was spoken down, this law, Ten Commandment law, the cardinal ordinances, okay? All this stuff here. Circumcision ceremonies, baptism, Passovers, sacrifice, Ten Commandment. There's a lot of them, okay? They couldn't keep it, okay? So John was sent, okay? John was, what do you say it? From his birth, it was told to his father, Zacharias, that he was going to be this voice crying out in the wilderness to make the way straight for the Messiah. In other words, he was going to point the Messiah out. Okay? Continue reading. Oh, there in Matthew.
Yahshua, when he was baptized, went up straightway out of the water. And lo, the heavens were opened unto him. And he saw the Spirit of Yahweh descending like a dove and lightning upon his head, on him. And lo, a voice from heaven saying, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased.
Okay. This only happened to the Messiah. Okay. Because he was the beloved Son. Okay. Now, for those of us that have been in here for a while, we understand that the Messiah, okay, was a manifestation of Yahweh Elohim. The only thing difference was he came in the likeness of sinful flesh. He was clothed in one of these. Nobody knew it. As he was walking around doing what he was doing since the time he was born, grew up, was under his father, kept these laws and all this stuff, they didn't know who he was. There's a scripture says, for if they would have known that that was Heavenly Father, or Yahweh, Elohim, they would not have killed him. Okay? Now, so here's the Messiah. His mission was to come and to fulfill. Okay? And then people say, well, what? Everything. Okay? There's a, I think, either Peter says, mentions it, that if they were to write everything the Messiah did, the world couldn't contain the books. Okay? So, that. Okay, now. So, Yahweh is spirit. Okay? Now, we go back to Moses to understand this spirit. Okay? So, we read about Moses. He was born out here in Egypt. He was a Levite, okay? His father was a Levite, his mother was a Levite, okay? He grew up. At that time when Moses was born, there was a death decree set out by the Pharaoh of Egypt, okay? Now, you want to read before what happened, you have to go back into Genesis and read the account. But we're starting here with Moses. We're being obedient, okay? Now, at that time, Pharaoh was having all the boy babies killed, okay? If it was, we picked that up in Exodus, picked that up around there, but anyway. So Moses was born at that time. His mother, okay, Jochebed, saw the child and saw that he was a goodly child, okay? It's written like that because that child had the Holy Spirit, okay? Now, everybody else, when they see their child, they, you know, oh, they're so precious, you know? But mother's not going to say their child's precious, okay? But it's written that way in that book. Now, one thing we got to remember is this whole thing here, remember Moses saw a panoramic vision, so he's writing about these events that he sees his own birth. He writes about it. He's the author, you know. Now, he sees himself being born, being raised, and being put in the Nile. Let's pick that up. Okay. In the flags of the Nile, in other words, these stalks, these willows, or whatever they got, was placed in there in an ark. She made an ark, you know, put slime in it to make it waterproof, you know, and put the baby in there, and his sister, Moses' sister, was hiding there to see what was going to happen to Moses, you know. So Pharaoh's daughter came out with some her servants, and she was going to bathe in the river, okay. So she heard the baby crying and told one of the handmaids to go see what's going on, you know, go fetch the baby. You get it?
Matthew 2 and 6, or 5. And the daughter of Pharaoh came down to
Bar.
Exodus 2 and 5. And the daughter of Pharaoh came down to wash herself at the river, and her maidens walked along by the river's side. And when she saw the ark among the flags, she sent her maid to fetch it. And when she had opened it, she saw the child, and behold, the boy wept. And she had compassion on him and said, this is one of the Hebrew's children.
Now, why would she say that this was one of the Hebrew's children? Okay. Egyptians knew the difference between a Hebrew and an Egyptian. Okay. The reason why is because this child was circumcised. Okay. Because all the way back, we have to go back and see, well, what's the circumcision all about? Okay. Well, there was 12 tribes out here of Israel. Israel was, the father of Israel was named Jacob, okay? Now, Jacob dwelt in Canaan's land, okay? And he had 12 sons, okay? During a famine, they were forced to come down looking for food into Egypt, okay? That's the story that was going before this. And they ended up here in Egypt, okay? And they stood there in the land of Goshen. There they multiplied. And then the Pharaoh of Egypt decided, you know, they're too many. They're going to overtake us one day. They're going to team up with our enemies and slaughter us, you know? So that's when he decided to start killing the boy babies, okay? Now, all the way from Joseph to the children of Israel coming down here in the land of Goshen, they knew that these people were circumcised, okay? Because they had the little ceremony where they circumcised the baby on the eighth day, according to a promise that was given to who? Abraham, okay? Abraham, in other words, the father of that nation, okay? And through his son, Isaac, he was going to bless the whole world, okay? Now, it's not because, like they show in the movie, the lady holds up the blanket, you know, oh, this is a Hebrew, you know, because of the blanket. No. No. It's because he was circumcised, okay? That's a principle. Circumcision is a principle. It's a spiritual. They did it in the physical, but it points to spiritual things. Just like a Romans 1:19-20. Okay, we're not going to get into it, but that's another thing. We're trying to get us to focus on what we're saying, because, man, you go with this thing and you'll see all kinds of stuff. Outside, you go start going here, going there, and forget kind of what you're going through. That's what I'm trying to maintain, you know. So anyway, you see these things happening in their principles, okay? Now, Moses grows up in the house of Pharaoh, okay? And he was about 40 years old. So he decides to come out and be amongst his brethren. And he sees something he didn't like. He's seen an Egyptian beating up on his brethren, okay? So Moses goes, let's get that part. Now Moses is playing right here a part of an intercessor. He intercedes between this Egyptian and this Hebrew, and the way he did it. Okay, you got it?
And it came to pass in those days when Moses was grown that he went out to his brethren and looked on their burdens. And he saw an Egyptian smiting a Hebrew, one of his brethren. And he looked this way and that way. And when he saw that there was no man, he slew the Egyptian and hid him in the sand. And when he went out the second day, behold, two men of the Hebrews were quarreling. And he said to him that did the wrong, wherefore smitest thou thy fellow? And he said, who made thee a prince and a judge over us? Intendest thou to kill me as thou killest the Egyptian? And Moses feared and said, surely this thing is known.
Yeah. So Moses goes out there with the intent of breaking up the fight, okay? Because he knows he's his brothers, you know? He's a Hebrew, they're a Hebrew, okay? Now, and the guy that did the wrong or was causing the problem down here turned around and told Moses, you're going to kill us same way you kill that Egyptian? So Moses feared for his life, not because he just killed an ordinary Egyptian, Because that Egyptian had a statue, okay? In other words, he was the son of Pharaoh, which was a ruler, okay? Or a judge, okay? Now, Moses flees for his life and goes into the land of Midian. And this is where the whole thing starts to happen, okay? He's sitting by a well, dressed up in all his Egyptian garb there, you know? So he's sitting there contemplating on what's going on, and these women come up with their sheep, and he's watching, and they start to water their sheep. He's sitting there, and all of a sudden, here comes these male shepherds with their sheep, and push the woman aside so they could water their own sheep. Here Moses gets up again to intercede, okay? And then the women got to water their sheep, and they go home. Now it turns out that these women, or these girls, were the daughters of the priest of Midian here, okay? Which is Jephro or Reuel. Jephro noticed that his daughters were home early. He goes, why are you here so early? Well, this Egyptian sitting by the well, he interceded between us, between the male and us, and let us water our sheep, and we're here early. And Jephro said, well, go fetch this man, you know. Let's pick it up right there.
And he said unto his daughters, and where is he? Why is it that you have left the man? Call him that he may eat bread. And Moses was content to dwell with the man, and he gave Moses Zipporah, his daughter. And she bare him a son, and he called his name Gershom, for he said, I have been a stranger in a strange land. And it came to pass in process of time that the king of Egypt died, and the children of Israel sighed by reason of the bondage when they cried, and their cry came up unto Elohim by reason of the bondage.
Okay. Remember, Moses is narrating this vision. Okay? He's seeing what's going down here, and he's writing about his own life. Okay? So he sees himself up here in this land. Jephro gives his daughter to him. They're together. They have a child. Okay? He names him. And he becomes Reuel's shepherd. So one day Moses is out here with the sheep, you know, this pasture out here and the sheep, and he sees something. He sees a vision of an angel in this bush. And this bush was burning. So he took a look at it to see it, but he noticed that it wasn't being consumed, you know. Now I know if we were to go out there and see something like that, and we know what, we could smell the smoke, we could, you know that something was burning, but he noticed it wasn't being consumed, okay? Pick that up, please.
Exodus 3:1. Now Moses kept the flock of Jephro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian, and he led the flock to the backside of the desert and came to the mountain of Elohim, even to Horeb. And the angel of Yahweh appeared unto him in a flame of fire out of the midst of a bush. And he looked, and behold, the bush burned with fire, and the bush was not consumed. And Moses said, I will now turn aside and see this great sight, why the bush does not burn. And when Yahweh saw that he turned aside to see, Elohim called unto him out of the midst of the bush.
Okay, so that's a Holy Name version. It says, Yahweh Elohim called unto Moses his name. Okay? Now, let me say at this time, nobody knew the name of Yahweh. From Adam all the way up to Moses. Because Moses is the first person he's going to reveal his name to. Okay? And see, that's why it's written like that, because Moses is writing down what he saw up here in the mount. Okay? Now, go ahead.
And Moses said, I will now turn aside and see this great sight, why the bush does not burn. And when Yahweh saw that he turned aside to see, Elohim called unto him out of the midst of the bush and said, Moses, Moses.
So
and he said,
this angel knew Moses' name. Read.
Moses, Moses. And he said, here am I. And he said, draw not nigh hither. Put off thy shoes from off thy feet. For the place whereon thou standest is holy ground.
Don't come any closer. Stay right there and take off your shoes. Read.
Moreover, he said, I am the Elohim of thy father, the Elohim of Abraham, the Elohim of Isaac, and the Elohim of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look upon Elohim.
So Yahweh Elohim introduces himself. Okay? Now, he said he was the Elohim of their forefathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. All right? Now, when we come in, this is where we have to go. Okay? This is where we understand, because we find out that the name was revealed to Moses. Okay? Now, he's telling Moses that he's commissioning Moses to go back down here into the land of Egypt. Now, before that, we read, okay, that the Pharaoh of Egypt was dead now. Okay? Moses writes that down. And then he continues on with the daughter of Midian, the daughter of Jethro, okay? So we know that he's writing this historical event down. Now, so he reveals his name to Moses, okay? Now, get to where he says, when I go back to down to the land of Egypt, okay, and they ask me, who sent you, okay? What God has sent you, okay? Get that part.
Exodus 3:13. And when Moses said, Moses said unto Elohim, behold, when I come unto the children of Israel, and shall say unto them, the Elohim of your fathers has sent me unto you, and they shall say to me, what is his name? What shall I say unto them?
Okay. Read that out of the King James Version.
And Moses said unto God, behold, when I come unto the children of Israel, and shall say unto them, the God of your fathers has sent me unto you, and they shall say to me, what is his name? What shall I say unto them? And okay. God.
Okay. Now, this is where we say that that's a pretty silly question. Okay? Because why? Because if God was a name, okay, Moses is asking a silly question. Okay? God is not a name. God is a title. Okay? That's what we have to understand in this school. Because we were taught a lie. Okay? That the Heavenly Father's name is Lord, God, and Jesus Christ. But here we have the proof that when he told the man, Moses, and Moses replied, when I go back down here, and they're going to ask me, the Elohim of Israel sent me unto you, and they say, well, what is his name? Okay? Here Moses is asking Yahweh Elohim. Okay? That's what he's going to take down here to the Israelites, okay? Now, after a little bit of research, we go do our research in the library or whatever to prove to ourselves, okay, that this is true, what's been taught to us. We have to go search out the Tetragrammaton, how it's laid out, you know. How to make that Tetragrammaton pronounceable in English, okay? We have to get the letter A and E, okay? And we show how, through this vision, how the man was created on the sixth day, and his name was Adam, and the woman was taken out of the man, and her name was Eve, okay? Now, that's what we do, we insert it between the, I know we've been through it a lot of times, okay? But this is how the event goes, okay? Now, Moses was also told to take some signs with him because, you know, he has to prove to Moses who he is. Because when he asked, what is your name? Let's get that reply where he tells Moses his name.
In the King James? Or?
You can say King James. Little King James.
And God said, what is his name? What shall I say unto them? 14. And God said unto Moses, I am that I am. And he said, thus shalt thou say unto the children of Israel, I am that sent me unto you.
Okay. Now, if we look at that phrase, I am that I am. In other words, like we're a man, and that's all we can be is a man. Okay? That's very simple. That's, in other words, it's limited. Limited. We're limited. We only live so long, we only can do so many things. Okay? But Yahweh is not limited. Okay? He's all in all and everything else. Okay? But let's read it out of the Holy Name Version with the correct renditions in there.
Exodus 3:14. And Elohim said unto Moses, Eya Asha Eya. And he said, thus shalt thou say unto the children of Israel, I will be has sent me unto you.
That's the correct thing. Now, it's right here. We have it on this fiery bush, Eya Asha Eya. Okay. And Moses is looking at it, okay, at this bush. I will be what I will to be, okay? He could be this angel here in this fiery bush. He tells Moses, what do you have in your hand? A rod. And cast it on the ground. He cast it on the ground, and what happened? It became a serpent, okay? Now, he tells Moses to pick it up by the tail. He picks it up by the tail, it becomes a serpent again, okay? He says, stick your hand in your bosom. Sticks his hand in his bosom, and he says, he pull it out. He pulls it out, it's all white like leprous, okay? You see what leprosy does, right? You ever seen pictures of leprosy? Look at it, Google it, okay? You'll see it, it's ugly. Okay, so he puts it back in, he pulls it out of his flesh like his other flesh, okay? So these are signs that he will be that serpent on the ground, or that diseased hand, and that well hand. Okay? And he was supposed to take these signs down into Egypt with him. Okay? And he performs these signs before Pharaoh. Okay? Now, so we get to this point now, and this you gotta read it to where I'm trying to get to the point to where he goes down there and he goes confronts Pharaoh to let the children of Israel leave. But get to that point where Yahweh tells him that he's not going to let him go because he's going to harden his heart. He's going to harden Pharaoh's heart. Yahweh Elohim. Okay? And the other thing he tells Moses when you read, he's seen the affliction of the children of Israel down here in the land of Egypt. Okay? Now he's up here in the bush talking to Moses, but he said he's seen the affliction down here. Okay? Now when we study, we find out, we come to class, and the instructors get up and show us, okay, that Yahshua's down here, appeared down here to be the age of 30, walking around the children of Israel, okay? So he sees the affliction while he's walking around here, manifesting the flesh, okay? Now, Moses, okay, in other words, he's astral projected himself up here in this bush. He's got Joshua the Messiah. Yahshua the Messiah. Okay? Astral projected himself because he's down here in Egypt. So he tells Moses to go down here. And he said, did you get that part where he says he's going to harden Pharaoh's heart?
Exodus 7:1. And Yahweh said unto Moses, see, I have made thee an El to Pharaoh, and Aaron thy brother shall be thy prophet. Thou shalt speak all that I command thee, and Aaron thy brother shall speak unto Pharaoh, and he send the children of Israel out of his land. And I will harden Pharaoh's heart, and will multiply my signs and my wonders in the land of Egypt. But Pharaoh shall not hearken unto you, that I may lay my hand upon Egypt, and bring forth my armies and my people, the children of Israel, in the land of Egypt, by great judgments. That's not it.
There's a part that says that he's going to harden Pharaoh's heart, so he won't let the children of Israel. Okay.
And he hardened Pharaoh's heart, that he hearkened not unto them, as Yahweh had said.
Right.
Okay. And Yahweh said unto Moses, Pharaoh's heart is hardened. He refuses to let the people go.
Okay, so Yahweh has something in store for Pharaoh and the Egyptians. Okay? So when Moses goes down there, okay, and Pharaoh refuses because his heart's hardened. Yahweh pointed out 10 devastating plagues over the land of Egypt. The first three, okay, the Israelites go through, okay? And the last seven, all of Egypt suffered, okay? But not the Israelites, no. The last plague was the plague of the death of the firstborn, which is the Passover, okay? Now Yahweh is instituting back here the Passover, okay? Now, when the children, he tells them how to do it, how to perform it, okay? What they have to do, basically, they had to take the lamb out. Oh, other thing. This is the beginning of a sacred calendar. Because he said, let this month be unto you the first month, Abib. Okay? On the 10th day, take out a lamb, hold it up to the 14th, and slay it between the two evenings. Okay? There is a take of the blood and strike it. Not rub it, not paint it, strike it. Okay? There's a reason why. There's a principle there. Why? Okay? Now, the principle about the lamb. That's what we have to look for, the principles. Okay? This lamb, took the blood of the lamb, they had to roast this lamb, eat it up, consume it, okay? And what was left over, okay, they had to burn it up with fire, okay? Now this lamb had to be in them, okay? And this blood had to be in the inside of their houses, okay? We're our house. Where's our blood? In the inside of us. Principles, okay? Now, because if they didn't do it, they weren't obedient, Yahweh Elohim was going to come over the land of Egypt, okay, through the night, where he didn't see the blood in the inside of those houses. He was going to smite the firstborn of every living man and beast, okay? And it did happen. And they had to be ready to leave. And before they left, they had to spoil the Egyptians. In other words, go in there and take all the valuables, okay, and anything they can carry with them, okay, because they're going to leave that land, and they're going to have to go through this Red Sea, okay, and how much time do I got? A couple minutes, or?
About 2 minutes more.
Okay. They have to come up here, maybe the next speaker go into it. What happened when they came up to the Red Sea, because since Pharaoh's heart got hardened again, he went after the children of Israel, alrighty? Now, I wanted to get to the point to where they saw this Elohim, okay, shape and form of man. But also Moses, when he goes up here the second time, sees this tabernacle pattern. Okay? Now that's the thing that we're going to understand about spirit. Okay? But my time's up, so hopefully the next time I put a little foundation there, the next speaker get into it, or whatever he feels to do. Okay, with that, yield the floor.
Thank you for that.
For our next speaker, I would like to call Dr. Christopher Williams.
Good morning, class.
Morning.
It's truly an honor and a pleasure to be given an opportunity to speak on this floor on some of the things that I've come to know and learn since being this great gospel. Should I use this end or switch around? Which one do I do?
We're going to cut it so you won't.
I'm just messing with it. I'm giving you a hard time.
Yeah.
I truly do appreciate everyone's presence in class, whether you're here on in live and in color or on the internet. Anytime you have an opportunity to listen to the gospel in simplicity, it's always an honor. It's always a pleasure. It's a good thing. I do appreciate the first speaker's comments about Moses. We may touch on that a little bit. I have a little something that's been on my heart and mind. And we're going to try to go into a different direction a little bit, but I'm going to touch on this a smidge. Something that I've been thinking about is the word truth. Can you get the definition of it? And also get lie. Truth is a funny thing. Everybody wants it, but nobody wants to acknowledge it. And everyone thinks they have it, but yet they don't use it. So, and please don't suffer from a vehicular Ambien today for the rest of this class. Thank you, I appreciate it. So whenever you have it, please let me know.
Okay. truth, veracity, truthfulness, verity, sincerity, candor, honesty, genuine.
What's the definition, not an synonym?
The definition says the quality or state of being true.
Keep going.
And then those are the synonyms.
Keep going down because I read
that,
this.
That which is true or in accordance with fact or reality.
There you go. Fact or reality. People will hear facts and will still avoid it, even though it's the reality.
Yeah.
Right.
The question is why? Yahweh told Moses, I'm going to send you to go to Pharaoh and tell him to let my people go. But here's the truth about Moses. I'm going to harden his heart. He told him what he was going to do, and he did it, and yet Moses still couldn't understand, why is he not listening to what I'm saying? I'm telling the truth, Yahweh told me this, right? So, we have truth, fact, reality. What's lie?
To make an untrue statement with intent to deceive, to create a false or misleading impression.
Right.
To affect by telling lies, lie his way out of trouble.
Okay. So let's talk about lies in the Bible. Because we have some, right? Well, some would say, no, the Bible's true and reality and everything. But, so, let's talk about the lie. Give me Genesis 3 and 1.
Genesis 3 and 1.
Mm-hmm.
Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which Yahweh Elohim had made.
Right.
And he said unto the woman, has Elohim said, you shall not eat of every tree of the garden?
So here we got the woman Eve talking to a serpent. And he's asking her this question about this tree that she keeps looking at, that she ain't got no business being next to greed.
And the woman said unto the serpent, we may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, Elohim has said, ye shall not eat of it, neither shall ye touch it, lest ye die.
Is that the truth? Mm-hmm. All right. Mm-hmm. So, the truth is, if you touch it, you're going to die. The serpent said.
And the serpent said unto the woman, no death will you die.
Is that a lie?
Yes.
A lie.
Well, let's see if it's true. Read.
For Elohim doth know that in the day ye eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened, and ye shall be as Elohim, knowing good and evil.
Is he lying or not?
Mm-hmm.
Excuse me? Is he lying?
Mm-hmm. No.
He is not lying.
He's not.
Satan took the truth and used it as deception. But we say he's the father of lies. He didn't lie to her.
Right.
She ate that fruit. Did she die?
Yes.
No, she did not.
Spiritual.
Right. He wasn't talking about a physical death, which she was unaware of. She was deceived with the truth. Just a little spin magic, right? You see that all the time. Fake news.
Yeah.
It's only fake because I'm telling you it. But the truth is sitting there staring you in the face. So that was fake news.
So she thought that she would be died physically? Is that what you're saying?
Was she carnal or not?
Yes.
Okay. Subject to vanity, right?
Yes.
So a carnal mind cannot comprehend spiritual principles. So he did not lie to her.
Right.
But he did deceive her.
Yes.
That's the point.
Nice.
Continue reading.
And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food and that it was pleasant to the eyes.
It looked just like all the other things she ate.
Mm-hmm.
So why can't she eat it?
Right.
Tastes just as good, if not better. It's doing the same thing everything else is. And he said, as soon as I touch it,
I'm gonna die, but hey, I'm still alive. I'm gonna eat.
Mm-hmm.
And she did just that. And then she said, man, let me take it a step further. Hey, Adam, here you go.
Yeah.
And all he can think is, oh, shucks, what did she just do?
Yeah.
He already knew. Read.
And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food,
uh-huh.
and that it was pleasant to the eyes,
mm-hmm.
and a tree to be desired to make one wise,
right.
she took of the fruit thereof and did eat,
mm-hmm.
and gave also unto her husband with her.
Read on.
And he did eat.
Read.
And the eyes of them both were open.
So, did Satan lie? Because he said, he knows in the moment that you eat this,
right.
your eyes are going to be open.
Right.
Knowing both good and evil.
Yeah.
And they knew in that very moment they were evil because they disobeyed Yahweh.
Mm-hmm.
He did not lie.
Mm-hmm.
But yet we call him the father of lies. What he did was pervert the truth
mm-hmm.
to suit his needs. And the problem with people is we allow ourselves to be deceived with truth. I'm not spinning this at all. The very first time I read this was read to me as a kid, I said, why is everyone saying that she was this, that he lied? He didn't lie.
Right.
Because as a kid, I learned about deception early. You can't be a Joe Williams kid and not learn about deception. Okay? Reason being is, I lied all the time. Not because I was a malicious kid, I didn't want to get my butt kicked. Because those were plentiful. Okay? So I had to learn the difference between lies and deception. Preachers get on this floor and talk about truth all the time, but they are deceiving their congregation. Am I right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay? So the thing about Yahweh is he does nothing without witnesses and proof. Now, for the longest time, there's a song called The Truth by NDRE. I love to listen to it. It's a great song. And for the longest time until I read the lyrics, I realized she's, if you don't know any better, you can be deceived by her words. And I don't think she means it maliciously, but she makes a comment. She has a lyric that says, there is no need, truth needs no proof. Proof, either it is or it isn't. The irony of that is, truth comes with proof.
Mm-hmm.
Or else you can't, or else it wouldn't be true. She's saying, you just know the truth by the way it feels. Well, Yahweh is not worried about your feelings.
Right.
That is the exact opposite of how Yahweh operates.
Mm-hmm.
Get me Hebrews 11 and 1. Also get me Hebrews 12 and 1. Get me 1 Thessalonians 5 and 21. And also get me Isaiah 28, 9 and 10. I'll give you time to get those. But give me Hebrews 12 first. Now,
Hebrews 12 and 1. Wherefore, we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which doth so easily beset us.
Read that again.
Wherefore, seeing we are also compassed about.
We are compassed about. Read.
With so great a cloud of witnesses.
A cloud of witnesses. Not a couple. Not a few, a cloud of witnesses. If this was the Three Amigos, it'd be a plethora, right?
Right.
We're talking about a cloud of witnesses that Yahweh is giving us to show us truth. Truth. Now the question is, why is the truth so hard to accept? That wasn't rhetorical. I'm taking anything you got to give me. Please tell me, why is truth so hard to accept?
No proof.
No, it's not about proof.
Because sometimes it requires change or action on our part.
Exactly. For years, Your mom has been telling you the best kid on the planet. For years, you're darling. You can do no wrong. That's how we're raised. We're lying to our children and ourselves on a daily basis. On a daily basis, we are giving ourselves this form. Telling ourselves this is what we look at. This is our reality. Thinking we're this. It's hard to face that you aren't this, that this is who you really are, but we convince ourselves that this is who we are. So when we have to see that we have not been displaying this, we go back to this because it's easy. We don't do this maliciously. This is years, eons of practice. Every parent has done it. Everybody does it. So when we are given the truth, like, there's no J in the Hebrew language to this day. Neither the Greek nor the Latin. There are people wholeheartedly still accepting Jesus Christ. Here's the crazy part. These are educated people. Scholars that are reading about this letter J, that have studied languages, Hebrew, Greek, Latin, English, and they know better. They have studied the history and the etymology of Jesus, the etymology of Christ, the etymology of God and Lord, and they know that Yahweh is the divine name that was given to man, and they know that this is the divine title, and that this is the name of the Holy Spirit, and yet they still believe the lie.
Right.
Why? Greed.
Yeah.
The corruption. Mm-hmm. We've already put it out. God, we're going to go backwards. No one wants to face the truth. There's money in Yash and in Jesus.
Right.
There's money in Lord and God.
That's right.
I can't make this up. If you were to tell 7 billion people, hey, we've been lying to you, they're not going to believe the truth anymore. First Thessalonians 5 and 21.
First.
Heaven help me, I gave you the scriptures.
5:21. Prove all things, hold fast that which is good.
So we're supposed to prove all things. You're saved in the name Henry Clifford Kinley.
No.
That's the truth now, right?
Mm-mm. That's a false statement.
How do you, why is that? I got a whole group of people saying that. That's the truth. It must be, it's on the internet. That is what is being said. Fake news. There's, oh, yes. Will kill us if we don't use the game thing.
I have this.
Go ahead.
For 10 seconds. I have this for too long in my mind. This one?
This one?
Yeah. So,
and can you repeat one more time? Prove all things where you find this in the Bible?
1 Thessalonians 5:21.
Can you read one more time, please?
Prove all things, hold fast to that which is good.
Okay, thank you. Which party had to prove all things? The one explaining or the one is receiving the information?
Both.
Right. I have this in my mind for so long, and I don't have a time to ask that question till now. Thank you so much for your answer. Correct.
So, and he brings up a very, very good point. The burden of proof is for all men to prove all things and hold fast that which is good. And what is good is the truth and not the deception. And that's why we come here, because this is a school. This is a school of the highest learning to learn about what? Our curriculum is what? The archetype. original plan, pattern of the universe, which is Elohim in itself, which is nothing more than a representation of this same spirit in a corporeal form that we can see, touch, and understand through truth. Hebrews 11:1.
Hebrews 11:1. Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen.
Now it says faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. Now that word faith in Christianity will lead you to believe that you're just supposed to believe it because I said it. Mm-hmm. Because I made it sound good. Because
right.
I dressed up real nice, used a lot of big words that were over your head, and it must be right because that guy went to Harvard. But that's not faith. And if you know anything about Yahweh, you know that he doesn't just say things just haphazardly, hoping that you'll believe it. Real quick, get me Isaiah
28.
No, not yet. 46:9-10.
Isaiah 26.
46:9-10.
46.
Yeah. 9 and 10. Remember the former things of old.
Read.
For I am El, and there is none else.
So there's, I am Elohim, and there is none else. Read.
I am Elohim, and there is none like me.
Okay, read.
Declaring the end from the beginning.
Read.
And from ancient times the things that are not yet done.
Read.
Saying, my counsel shall stand, and I will do all my pleasure.
Read.
Calling the eagle from the east, the man that executed my counsel.
Read.
From a far country.
Hey, where's the scripture? I am Yahweh and I change not. I can't think of it. Come down.
22.
Is it
45 and 5?
Yes. Is it 5? Yeah. 45 and 5. I am Yahweh and there is none else. There is no Elohim besides me. I girded thee, though thou hast not known me.
Mm-mm.
Not
the word change, huh? Mm-mm.
I change
not. Yeah. Okay. Oh. Mm-mm. Mm-mm.
What are you looking for?
Google it.
Call it.
Malachi 3:6.
That makes sense.
Yep. Malachi 3:6.
Read.
Malachi 3:6. For I am Yahweh, I change not.
Okay. So we have Yahweh saying, I'm Yahweh and there's none else. I am Yahweh, and I change not.
Yes.
So that means he's not going to change his principles just to suit your needs.
Correct.
This ain't Burger King. You don't get to have it your way. So if that be the case, and he's telling you that your faith is established based on proof, because that's what it's saying. Read it again. Hebrews 11:1.
Hebrews 11:1.
Read.
Now faith is the substance of things hoped for.
Uh-huh.
The evidence of things not seen.
So that means you're hoping for something, and the only way you're going to get it is through evidence. You want to find out the truth, but you need evidence to prove the truth. So here's Yahweh saying, prove all things, hold fast, that's what is good. I am Yahweh, and I change not. And just to bring it home, give me, some of them. I just had it.
How does it go?
No, I have it. 1 Timothy. Oh,
what was it, 2 Timothy? 1 Timothy. Jeez Louise.
What are you looking for?
Study to show thyself improved. I just had all the scriptures, just make sure I don't do this. And here I am doing it all over again.
2:15, 2 Timothy 2:15.
There you go.
Study to show thyself approved unto Yahweh.
Read.
A workman that needed not to be ashamed.
Read.
Rightly dividing the word of truth.
So how are you going to be able to divide the word of truth, figure out what's valid in this age versus what's valid in that age, if you don't study to show thyself approved, to know that Yahweh changes not, to know that he's got us after faith with proof? Now you can go back to Hebrews and we can continue reading.
Mm-hmm. 11. Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, uh-huh, the evidence of things not seen.
Read.
For by it the elders obtain a good report.
So they got a good report based on the evidence that was given to them by Yahweh. Read.
Through faith we understand that the ages were ordained by the word of Elohim.
In the King James Version that says the ages were framed,
right, by the word of Yahweh.
So we have these ages and dispensations here, and they are framed based on the evidence of man that Yahweh used for his truth. Adam helped frame the antediluvian age, as well as Noah. And then Abraham and Melchizedek. No, Moses, Henry Cliff killing us, right? Read.
By faith, Abel offered unto Yahweh a more excellent sacrifice than Cain.
So, Cain gave the first fruits, correct? Mm-hmm. Abel sacrificed a lamb, correct? Mm-hmm. It wasn't that Cain's sacrifice wasn't good. It just wasn't time for it.
Right.
He needed to rightly divide the word of truth, meaning right now, it wasn't time for the first fruits. Mm-hmm. Because the first fruits hadn't arrived yet.
Right.
The first fruits wasn't supposed to arrive until here.
Mm-hmm.
But Cain, not understanding because he was carnal in his mind and his thinking, deceived himself that he couldn't see that he was at fault for making this bad decision. Mm-hmm. Cain, realizing, hey, I need to give the appropriate sacrifice, gave the right one. Read.
By which he obtained witness that he was righteous,
mm-hmm,
Yahweh testifying of his gifts, and by it, he being dead, yet speaketh.
Read.
By faith, Enoch was translated that he should not see death.
Read.
And was not found because Yahweh had translated him.
Mm-hmm.
But before this, his translation, he had this testimony that he pleased Yahweh.
Read.
But without faith, it is impossible to please him.
So if you don't have faith or evidence that is going to establish your faith, you are not going to please Yahweh.
Right.
I am Yahweh, not changing not. Study to show thyself approved. Prove all things. Hold fast to that which is true. To that which is good. So we're doing all these things to do what? Bring about truth. Something that no one wants to face, but they want it. Women, don't lie to me. Right?
That's right.
Does this dress make me look fat? Which one do I do? Do I tell you the truth or do I lie to you? Michael, you already know. Don't answer that question, right? Why is that? Don't ask a question if you don't want to answer.
That's true.
Baby, do you love me? Do you really want me to answer that question?
No, really.
You should.
Do you get what I'm saying? This is something we do on a daily basis. So we don't come to class to hear about Moses and Noah and Abraham so we can leave it on in the Bible. We come here to learn about why these things happen to us in our daily life.
Yes.
Well,
The reason why these things happen is that these stories or these principles that we come here to learn is to show us why we are walking in the same vein.
Right.
Our journey is just this. You are in Egypt, mm-hmm. metaphorically speaking. You resurrect out of Egypt at some point in your life into the most holy place or the wilderness, metaphorically speaking. Mm-hmm. And eventually you'll get to your inheritance or out of that bondage that you're in, and then guess what? You do it all over again. That is why we come here. Why is my husband beating the hell out of me? Because you're in bondage. You need to get out of it. Why is my boss kicking my tail every day? Because you're in bondage. You're being immersed in all that negativity. That's why we come here. To learn the truth so that we can use it to arm ourselves to sojourn on this earth.
Right.
That's it. We're not here for any other reason. We don't come to class just to hear me speak. I ain't that special. Maybe to my son, but that's it. Do you get my point? Don't come here for any other reason. Let me give you some truth. Sundays was my day, my happy day. For one, I hate working on Sundays. It feels like, I can work 6 days a week, but if I gotta work on a Sunday, it's like I work all God's time month, okay? Yeah, I almost said it. I'm
yes,
proud of that.
Yes, but
my point is, I hated working on Sundays. So I made sure that whatever job I got, I'm not working on Sunday. If I gotta work on a Sunday, I quit. Later on in life, Sundays became my favorite day. That was the only time I got a chance to see my dad. Because the guy was just too busy during the week. Even when I wanted to see him, I had to catch him at work or something. You can't talk to somebody when they're at work. I mean, I literally walked in to go talk to him. He's in there suturing somebody, bloody hand all over the place, bleeding out. Like, who wants to see that? But he would literally be talking to me, talking to him, suturing the guy, like, hey, man, having a real conversation. I'm like, who does this? But that's the only way you could see Joe Williams during the week. And now I hate Sundays. That's the truth. And that's a hard thing to do. Because I love coming here, but I hate not being able to see my father anymore.
Yes.
It's hard. But the reality is, this is what Yahweh had purposed from the foundation of the earth.
Yes.
That this day would come. There was going to be a time where we're going to lose. That's the truth. The lie is, they'll be here forever. That's why you can't. That's why we say you can't take it with you.
That's true.
Right?
Right. Mm-hmm.
So what you holding on to it for?
Really?
I never will understand the greed of man. Mm-hmm. The truth is, there's enough money and resources with individuals to share with the collective, and everyone can prosper. But they will lie to you and say, "Oh no, there's just not enough." But that's not the truth. The truth is, man is greedy.
Yes.
We are carnal.
Yes.
We have corrupt minds.
Yes.
Some malicious and some not malicious. We believe our mortality entitles us into an abundance of resources at the expense of others. We use our theories, concepts, and opinions to show you how we think you should feel, but not reveal the truth of the matter. Have you ever tried to convince? Forget that. You know, it's the scripture of Jesus. It says Joshua wept.
Right.
Why did Joshua weep?
Because we didn't know.
Fulfilled.
Not just that.
No, we don't know.
He was dealing with a carnal mind.
Yeah.
That's how we feel when we deal with carnal-minded people. You can present truth all day long. And because they don't want to believe that there is a principle of a death, burial, and resurrection throughout the scriptures, and that we're supposed to stick to that, we will believe falsehoods and theories, concepts, and opinions because it sounds good. just like you are saved in the name of Henry Clifford Kennedy. I really, literally can't make this up. But we have aims that we got direct from the Bible itself. We have the proof that's sitting right in front of us, and yet we believe the lie. That I just can't fathom. Our first aim is to help you find and know Yahweh as He really is and actually exists. In order for us to do that, we have to show you some proof to establish your faith that, one, He does exist. The next aim is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua Messiah without any distinction of race, nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. That means it doesn't matter if you're black, you're white, you're Asian, you're brown, you're a woman, you're a kid, you're a cat, you're a dog, you can be in Yahshua Messiah. And the only way we can do that is by investigating the unexplained spirit law or the so-called laws of nature and the powers latent in man. Because we've all been imbued with a measure of intelligence, wisdom, and knowledge, beauty, love, and justice, foundation, power, and strength, so we can discern these principles in the scriptures and in others. We encourage and promote the study of the scriptures compared to religions, psychology, philosophy, modern practical and occult sciences. We'll spend an hour talking about how this pattern that we have, this tabernacle pattern, is scientific. He used the elements to prove the authenticity of Exodus 8 and 7. To prove that this structure here is in operation throughout eternity. He showed through principles of the elements how that every element is represented on this pattern. That's science. Scientists will lead you to believe that God doesn't exist because we can't see it.
Right. Yeah.
Romans 1:19 and 20 says, because that which may be known of Yahweh is manifest in who? In them.
Right?
Mm-hmm. So in order to see Yahweh, you got to see something physical, because this is spirit. We talked about it in moderation. It is indescribable, indiscernible, inscrutable. You can't see it with your natural physical eyes. But because Yahweh so loved the world, He gave you a manifestation of that through the man. We are the proof that Yahweh exists. Mm-hmm. See, there's a reason why planets don't bump into each other.
Right.
There's a reason why comets whiz back and forth, and yet we are unscathed. We don't have any problems. Mm-hmm. They ain't comet bust into the earth. There's a reason for that. There's a reason why your heart beats without you thinking about it.
Right.
It is called your autonomic nervous system that keeps your heart beating, your lungs breathing, and your blood pumping. Mm-hmm. It's the reason why you have absorption throughout your body. You have all these functions that are working without your knowledge, help, or aid. And that's because you have spirit operating in your body, within your temple, which is nothing more than Yahweh itself.
Right.
So if you want to know how Yahweh is and actually exists, don't look over there, look within. Yeah. That's the truth. Mm-hmm. But yet, people will not believe that.
Right.
Why? Because we look like our minds change. We question our morals. We have this temporal body, so there's no possibility that we are Yahweh in a body. We are corrupt all the time, right? Maybe not maliciously, but I'll be honest with you. I have my moments. I ain't gonna lie.
You can't help it.
Do you understand? We do still have these human conditions. Mm-hmm. But yet, the Holy Spirit is dwelling with you, within you, if you believe the report. And what's the report? That Yahshua Messiah died for our sins. Right. Ascended, and then the outpouring of the Holy Spirit was made us recipients of the inheritance of the sons of light, right? Mm-hmm. But we can only believe that if we go and study to show ourselves proof. To learn about the truth about why this man got on this cross.
Right.
And he got on this cross for one reason. Matthew 5:17.
Matthew 5:17. Mm-hmm. Think not that I am come to destroy the law of the prophets.
Read.
I am not come to destroy, but to fulfill.
Now, the Christianity teaches that Yahshua the Messiah came to set up a Christian way of life. Mm-hmm. To show us an example of how to live. But that was not the case. His words, the truth is, he said what?
I am not come to destroy, but to fulfill.
So in order to fulfill something, and we read this definition all the time, it means he had to perform something. And what was he performing? 4,000 years of people, places, and things according to the scriptures. I am Yahweh, and I change not. Prove all things. Study to show thyself approved. We read these scriptures for a reason. Because that those principles keep coming up and repeating themselves. So yet we have the Messiah telling you what his mission was. To fulfill. He's performing some things. So what is he performing? The law and the prophets. Right? Jeremiah 31:31, please.
Jeremiah 31:31.
Mm-hmm.
Behold, the days come, saith Yahweh,
read,
that I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah.
So there's got to be, in order to have a new covenant, there's got to be an old covenant. Mm-hmm. This old covenant was nothing more than circumcision, ceremonies, baptism, Passover, sacrifices, Ten Commandment laws, 613 judgment statutes and ordinances that they had to live by on a daily basis. But yet, in today's world, we only talk about 10.
Right.
If it was only 10, there would be no need for the Messiah. I'm just going to be frank with you. If I knew, I don't even know about that, because some people would fail. If they said, thou should not covet that neighbor, nah. There's a whole lot of coveting going on in this world, I'll be honest with you.
That's true.
Thou shalt not kill.
That's a lot of that.
It is what it is.
Yes.
The point is this. If it was left up to just the 10, I think we'd be all right. But 613 judgment statutes and ordinances that they had to live by, that was a tall order. And no one could do it. Because the consequence was death. Mm-hmm. And that was the problem. It was a burden. Those poor animals were by the droves, just dying. I mean, if you were broke, sorry for you. Do you get what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So it necessitated Yahweh to send his son to die for our sins.
Right.
And he wasn't just dying for like us today. He was dying for everyone. Before us and after us. We do that ourselves, right? Our inheritance is the Holy Spirit, right? And that's something that's continuing even after we pass. Likewise, we work our lives to provide for our families and for ourselves so that when we pass, we leave something, a legacy for our children or for our family, right?
Correct.
Because some people don't have children. Well, some people have, they just have stuff.
Yeah.
But that's got to go somewhere. And your legacy is tied to those possessions. In principle, we're doing the same thing. But it takes everything that Yahweh did through Yahshua Messiah so we can have those things. So when we talk about him fulfilling, what did he, in order to fulfill something, he had to establish something somewhere.
Yeah,
Right. And that brings us back to Moses, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. Moses is the one that got this ball rolling. At least that's who Yahweh used. Mm-hmm. A whole lot of things happened getting up to Moses, right?
Right.
But once Moses got on the scene, that's when the purpose and plan of Yahweh was really on center stage. Mm-hmm. At least according to the Bible.
Right.
So, we have Moses receiving the name of Yahweh. And the only way he was going to receive that is through his ministry, Yahshua. Right? Because the reason why Joshua was down here was so that he can save his people. See, everyone thought it was Moses that was saving him. Mm-hmm. Moses was just a figure. He wanted him to look at him. Yahweh wanted everyone to look at Moses because it wasn't time to reveal the Messiah yet. Mm-hmm. Just like Abel gave the appropriate sacrifice back here and Cain gave the inappropriate sacrifice, mm-hmm. likewise, it was inappropriate for everyone to see Joshua, the son of Nun, in that role, because it wasn't time yet.
Right.
He was there to set up this thing that was going to culminate when they crossed over into Canaan's land, and eventually the Messiah would come and die for our sins. Because he said he's coming to fulfill.
Right.
In order to fulfill, he had to set up the contract. Well, he set that contract up with Abraham, but it didn't come into effect until Moses showed up, started handing down some laws, right? And that next thing you know, here we are. So we have Yahshua, the son of Nun, down here instituting the scriptures, instituting this thing that Yahshua is going to fulfill, right? So we have Yahshua, the son of Nun. Let's get it. Exodus 25, 9 and 10. 24, 9 and 10.
Exodus 24 and 1.
Read.
And he said unto Moses,
uh-huh.
Come up unto Yahweh,
mm-hmm.
thou, Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu,
mm-hmm.
and 70 of the elders of Israel,
read.
And worship ye afar off.
Uh-huh.
And Moses alone shall come up near Yahweh.
Read.
But they shall not come nigh, neither shall the people go up with them. And Moses came and told the people all the words of Yahweh and all the judgments. And all the people answered with one voice and said, all the words which Yahweh has said will we do.
So we have we have everyone around this mount because he's getting ready to ascend. And he says, everything that Yahweh said will we do. So it's kind of like a marriage, right?
Mm-hmm.
So we have a marriage between Yahweh and his people. And that's the institution of this contract that we have here, the old covenant. And we said, in order for us to get a new covenant with the house of Israel, with the house of Judah, we have to start this first one, this covenant first, in order to receive the new one. And the reason why we have this old one is because it was a burden to them. And the Messiah was here to take on that burden because we couldn't hold it. I'll be honest with you. I could probably do 8 out of 10. I'll be frank. I must have violated them all. But if you had to give me, if I start from scratch, I could probably do 8 out of 10. I'm just gonna be frank, because at the end of the day, what we talked about earlier is that we've been conditioning ourselves to believe a lie, and that's what we do, right? We don't even lie. We don't even know we lie half the time when we do it. That's what's scary about this.
Yeah.
I know a person now that lies for the sake of lying because they don't feel comfortable telling the truth. I ain't joking. Listen, I can say, hey, how you doing? Oh, I'm dying. Really? Where you at right now? I'm at the club. I'm not joking. But that's the condition that we put ourselves under because we don't want to believe the truth.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'll be honest with you. When I was married and all these things, I felt I presented a certain facade that everyone would see and think great about. Oh, Chris is a family man. He's got everything going for himself. And inside, I was dying, because that's not who I was. I had to divorce myself, not just from the person I was married to, but from that carnality that I had presented to everyone, because it wasn't who I really was. I wasn't happy. I wasn't good within myself. I didn't like who. I didn't like brush my teeth. I didn't want to see the person in the mirror, because I wasn't who I was supposed to be. Not what I think I am, but who I really am. And it took a lot of reflection, a lot of searching, soul searching, to realize that, hey, this is who you are. Don't misconstrue this. I wasn't all that. But I had some things I had to deal with. Some truths I had to acknowledge and accept. And like you said, I had to change, which was hard to do. 30-some years of being this lie, it's hard to shake, right? But through the preaching of the gospel and Yahweh's patience with me, he was able to show me where I needed to go. See, the great thing about this gospel is, despite who we are, good or bad, we always have redemption through Yahshua Messiah.
Right. Sure.
You don't have to remain in darkness forever. Like, we come here to die, be immersed in that death, and then resurrect out of it, because he did it for us. He was the living example for us to continue on learning from. That's why we come here. That's why he did what he did, for us to realize that reality, that truth. And not believe the lie that, well, I messed up. That's all it is, and all it is to it. That's not what we're here for. Mm-hmm. But he set up these scriptures. He set up these stories for us to learn from. And he came and did it for himself so that we can see the lesson. So now we have Yahweh ascending on here to do what? Read.
Which one was it?
I think five.
Well, and Moses came and told the people. Okay. And Moses wrote all the words of Yahweh and rose up early in the morning, mm-hmm. and built an altar under the hill and 12 pillars according to the 12 tribes of Israel.
Read.
And he sent young men of the children of Israel, which offered burnt offerings and sacrificed peace offerings.
To nine.
Then went up Moses and Aaron, Nadab and Abihu,
Read.
And 70 of the elders of Israel.
Read.
And they saw the Elohim of Israel, and there was under his feet, as it were, a paved work of a sapphire stone.
Now, we have it pictorially illustrated here that they were supposed to come to the mount. These 70 elders were supposed to wait. He's going to be right back. Now, right back didn't just happen. He was up there for some 40 days and 40 nights. But he said, hey, if you got any problems, Aaron and Hur are here to take care of your problems. But wait for me to come back down. So we got Moses ascending with Joshua. And the lie is, the truth is, he was really going up by himself, right? Now, to someone who don't know better, they think, hey, there's something wrong here. Why is Joshua going up with Moses when he said, come up on the mountain by yourself? So that should tell you, in and of itself, who that man was. Read.
As it were a paved work of a sapphire stone, and as it were the body of heaven in its clearness.
Read.
And upon the noble of the children of Israel, he laid not his hand.
Now, I used to read that as a kid. I said, what the heck does that mean? Now, he said that upon the noble of the children of Israel, he laid not his hand. Now, if you read in the Bible any time about him laying his hand on someone, it is the hand of understanding. So, preachers do it now because they think that's them healing people, right? They think that's the hand of healing. But really, it is the understanding of what they're actually seeing. Because when Dr. Kinley saw Yahweh, he got some understanding because he was given a revelation. Same thing with Moses. See, the first time he saw this, he's like, wow, I just saw something really great. And he came back down and got mad, waxed hot, and broke this table of stone on the calf, right? Mm-hmm. But when he went back up again, and he saw it in its entirety, and he saw the reality of what he was supposed to see, then he had some understanding. Because when he came back down the first time, he was a normal man. But if you know, when he comes down the third time, he had to put a veil on his face because it shone, because he had understanding of what he was seeing. So that hand of understanding was laid upon him. And if you read throughout the scriptures, anytime Yahweh lays his hand on them, all of a sudden they're a new man. But I digress, read.
Also, they saw Elohim and did eat and drink.
Read.
And Yahweh said unto Moses, uh-huh. Come up to me and to the mount and be there.
Mm-hmm.
And I will give thee tables of stone.
Read.
And a law.
Read.
And commandments which I have written.
Read.
That thou mayest teach them.
Mm-hmm.
And Moses rose up and his minister Joshua.
Read.
And Moses went up into the mount of Elohim. And he said unto the elders, tarry ye here for us.
He said, wait up, wait for me, guys. I'll be right back. Read.
Until we come again unto you. And behold, Aaron and Hur are with you.
Mm-hmm.
If any man have any matters to do, let him come unto them.
Read.
And Moses went up into the mount,
mm-hmm.
and a cloud covered the mount. And the glory of Yahweh abode upon Mount Sinai. And the cloud covered it 6 days, colon. And the seventh day, he called unto Moses out of the midst of the cloud.
So we have the cloud. So we have the cloud. We have Moses in the cloud for 6 days, and there's a colon there. Now that colon is supposed to. There's supposed to be some understanding behind that, right? And what we've come to know and learn is that after that colon, those 6 days was really more nothing more than 6 days. The 6 days of creation, right?
Mm-hmm.
And it says on the seventh day he rested, which we have pictorially illustrated. Now, we see Moses and Aaron, Nadab and Abihu, and 70 elders here instituting with Joshua, correct?
Mm-hmm.
Now, we said that the Messiah was doing nothing more than fulfilling that which he instituted, correct?
Right.
So we need to see the Messiah doing something similar to that to prove our point. Because the whole point is just about showing proof that Yahweh was not changing, and that he was giving nothing more than truth, right?
Mm-hmm.
So, we need, what is it? John 14, 26? No, not 14, 26, I'm sorry. Matthew 16.
Beginning?
16:01.
16:01. The Pharisees also with the Sadducees.
17,
came.
Sorry.
Yeah, right. Okay. And after 6 days, Joshua taketh Peter, James, and John, his brother, and bringeth them up into a high mountain apart.
How many days was that?
Six.
I swear I can't make this stuff up. Read.
Yeah. And was transfigured before them, and his face did shine as the sun.
Okay.
And his raiment was white as the light.
So we have it pictorially illustrated that Messiah took who?
Peter, James, and John.
So he took Peter, James, and John. So Peter was the elder, James and John were brothers. Kind of looks like Aaron, the elder, and then Nadab and Abihu. Correct?
Right.
Read.
And behold, there appeared unto them Moses and Elijah talking with them. Then answered Peter and said unto Joshua,
read.
Sire, it is good for us to be here.
Read.
If thou wilt, let us make here three tabernacles.
Now, why is he talking about a dang tabernacle on this mount that they're on?
Back there with Moses.
So here we have Peter, James, and John seeing a transfiguration of Moses and John the Baptist on top of a mountain. And we're talking about a tabernacle. Because he's fulfilling what Moses saw. How that Moses was ascended up into a high mountain, and Joshua transfigured into the 6 days of creation. Read.
If thou wilt, let us make thee three tabernacles, one for thee, mm-hmm. and one for Moses, and one for Elijah.
Read.
While he yet spake, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them.
Mm-hmm.
And behold, a voice out of the cloud which said, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased.
Read.
Hear ye him. And when the disciples heard it, they fell on their faces and were greatly frightened.
I would be afraid too, because I ain't never seen nothing like that before.
Mm-hmm.
So, shortly after this happened, 70 people were chosen to go out and preach to the nations, two by two. Just like there were 70 elders that witnessed to this one thing. Because these 70 chosen were the ones that witnessed the Messiah's, all his acts that he was doing, all the healings and all those things. And they were preaching the gospel of Yahshua the Messiah, getting everyone ready for this death, burial, and resurrection and outpouring of the Holy Spirit.
Right.
The point is, the truth is staring us all in the face every day. Yahweh doesn't need anything more than his creation to prove his existence. There's proof everywhere. The question is, are we going to believe the report? Has your faith been established based on the evidence that is seen? He's given us nothing more than tools and witnesses, a cloud of witnesses, to prove his very existence and that his gospel is true and correct. You just need to read and study thyself to show thyself approved.
Mm-hmm.
I hope and trust you got something I will set today. Thank you very much for the time. Hallelujah.
That will conclude today's lectures. Thank you all for coming out to join us. We've got a couple of announcements. Do you guys have any announcements? Okay. One of the announcements is that we do need scripture readers and moderators. So if anybody would like to be a scripture reader or a moderator for our lectures, please see me for more information. For our YouTube viewers out there, there may be a delay of uploading some of our lectures for the next 2 weeks. If you have access to Facebook, you'll be able to view our lectures live streaming and recorded by joining our Facebook group named IDMR Ontario Class. Our members who have upload access, they'll be out of town, so they'll upload everything on their return. So if you miss us for a little while, we'll be back, and just be patient. I'd like to thank our returning visitor for coming and visiting us, and we encourage you to return and study with us some more. Yes?
For Tuesday night class, read Kenosis in the Elohim book. That's what we're going to be going over.
Okay, so we'll be studying Kenosis. And if you have access to the Elohim book, the Archetype Original Pattern, read that in preparation for that. We hold classes here at 1816 East Elma Court in Ontario, California, on Tuesdays and Thursdays from 7:30 p.m. to 9:30 p.m. and on Sunday from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. And every fourth Sunday of the month, we have a Spanish class from 9:30 a.m. to 10:45 a.m. And any donations can be received by our treasurer, Dr. Eunice Reiser. And with all of that, I'd like everybody to stand to be dismissed of the doxology. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise Elohim, our Savior, through Yahshua the Messiah, our Sovereign, belong glory and majesty, dominion and power, both before all time, now and ever. Let us all say, Hallelujah.
Morning, Linus.
Hey,
baby. I like to say you stay in the morning.
Hey, kids, no running.
Delightful.
Oh, moderator.
How was church?
Oh, that it may be a delay yet because there's nobody else who has software on their
I'll find out right now.
He gave us a list of steps.
You can stop it. You stopped it?
No. Just go right here.